The following program is classified PG. Parental guidance is recommended for viewers under the age of 15.
Over the years, I'd had the pleasure of interviewing Michael Gudinski many times. And not too long ago, I was lucky enough to sit down with him again. And I had never seen him so passionate about Australian music and its fans. He talked so openly about his life, his glittering career, and how grateful he was to his nation. This is the Gudinski story by the late, great Michael Gudinski. Michael, you were always going to make your life in music, weren't you? It was going to happen.
Well, look, I had a bad music teacher, which was mostly a good thing, and I think I'm pretty good at it because I'm not a frustrated pop star. When I was about 14 or 15, I really got into a lot of great music through a few friends, and we decided to run a couple of dances during the school holidays. It was a good way to meet girls and have fun. Really, that's how it all began.
And what was that music you got into?
Look, I loved a lot of American music, English music. I mean, the Cream, the Yardbirds, the Doors.
Led Zeppelin.
Vanilla Fudge, Led Zeppelin for sure. And Australia had a lot of great music, but it was a time in the late 60s where Australians thought everything that was imported was better, whether it was cars, clothes or music. And I saw a band called The Loved Ones when I was really young. There used to be lunchtime concerts at a little disco in the city. And Jerry Humphries was the most amazing, charismatic character. He was Michael Hutchins before Michael Hutchins, and INXS actually recorded the song The Loved One. So once I started to really get into it, I realised I was going to flunk school. It was a big decision to make because I'd been offered a job. The first person I'd ever went on the road with was during the school holidays. It was with Bon Scott, who was the leader of the Valentines. And he was such a good guy, and it was just such an eye-opener. We went on a Greyhound bus to Adelaide. Vince Lovegrove, who's also passed away, was the other singer, but they were a pop band.
Mm.
And music has gone into cycles as we go along. But
how could you not get hooked?
I literally did get hooked, and my family were overseas at the time, and I guess I jumped out of school and promptly got thrown out of the house as soon as they came home. Good on your dad, there was no bad vibes. It just made me realise that there was a vision and a dream. I mean, I worked in cloakrooms, I put up posters, and I think that, you know, coming from the roots up in any business in that era is the way to go. The Australian music business was very backyard, unprofessional, and it needed a change. And I think I was in the right spot at the right time with the right ideas.
But you still recognised good talent, Michael, didn't you?
Yeah, I did, and I loved original talent. In those days, the venues were Coke and Fanta, and there was so much great talent that seemed to go nowhere. Believe it or not, the creativity had been taken out of the business. Half the big labels didn't record Australian music. The ones that did told them what to record, cover versions of English hits, who was going to produce them, what their cover was going to look like. And to me, in a creative business, there was no big plan for Mushroom Records. It was just something that naturally evolved. I was in an agency called Consolidated Rock. I always loved good names for businesses. And my partner managed Billy Thorpe and Doug Parkinson, and I managed The Chain, Carson and Healing Force, and that was really the birth of everything that really came about. But the key to everything really was the Sunbury Music Festival. It was Australia's Woodstock. It's hard to relate because Woodstock had 500,000 and Sunbury had 35,000, but it was the first time that all Australian lineup was celebrated, and it really, I think, was the birth of a whole decade of pub rock, great Australian talent, and Australian music was alive and well.
And you were 20. You were 20 at that stage when you were promoting Sunbury.
I was a stage manager at Sunbury. There was no university for this sort of thing at the time. And, you know, I made some mistakes, but I learned very young. No matter how hip, cool and groovy we were, we couldn't pay the bills, we were shit. Simple as that. And I think that's an experience that most entrepreneurs have. And in a way, I was glad it happened when I was very young. And then really Mushroom Records started.
You founded Mushroom not long after that?
Not long after that at all. The first album was a triple album of the Sudbury Music Festival, 73. And we wanted to make a statement that the label was here to stay. And we looked like we were doing very well. But it was a battle. It was a battle with radio. It was a battle because of the image of Australian music being second rate.
Or seen as second rate.
That's for sure. Mm. And look, suddenly and luckily, in the nick of time, a hero arose and the Skyhooks came along and they really put us on the map.
And Skyhooks, correct me if I'm wrong, 16 weeks at number one and the biggest selling album of any album in Australia up until that time.
It was a phenomenon. I remember going in, we only had a few staff at the time, and we had five songs from the album banned, and everyone was just absolutely panicking. I said, when's the last time you ever heard Australian radio play a whole album? And it actually worked in our favour.
Was this sort of the birth of the Australian sound? Would you say Skyhooks and Sherbet were our first real Australian sound?
A lot of people talk about the Australian sound. The Australian sound is Indigenous music. I think it was interesting the Skyhooks happened. Perhaps we definitely waited too long to go to America, because I always regarded Skyhooks as an intelligent version of Kiss. And by the time we went to America, because there was a huge tyranny of distance in those days, perhaps it was a bit late, but I mean, Kiss were an absolute phenomenon. In fact, on our first American tour, we were supposed to support Kiss in Cleveland, Ohio. And when they saw the band all made up and all that, it was, boys, there's the door.
Right, you're too much like us.
That just makes you work harder.
And you were shown the door and out you went.
Yep.
That would have been hard.
Ah, look, it was just, I took it as a compliment. America was a very, very big place. I mean, Jacksonville was the home of Skyhooks. We could sell 10,000 tickets there and we didn't do nothing anywhere else. And it's a very big market. Perhaps I made a mistake myself and didn't go and live there. We set up an office over there, but I was determined. I felt Australia was the lucky country. I wanted to be a big fish in a smaller sea. I had kids. I wanted to drive by my old school. I loved Melbourne. I was the only Gudinski born in Melbourne. It had a deep impact on me seeing my parents come out here with nothing, never talking about the war.
Russian immigrants, weren't they?
Yeah. And to see him do it again, he was staunch. I think if I was born in Russia, the rock business wouldn't have been good for me.
No. So you're saying there's no real Australian sound?
Look, Australia had a sound because our bands had the pub scene. Melbourne was very lucky. All the big labels were based in Sydney, and Melbourne was Mushroom. And, you know, being Mushroom in Melbourne, we had In Melbourne Tonight, we had Countdown down here, we had the fantastic Night Moves, one to give Molly a bit of a run, which me and my mate Lee Simon worked on. But I'll never forget Paul Kelly standing on the steps of Parliament House after the massive walk through the city with 20,000 people and saying, my university are these small venues that allow you to play original music. And I think we were very lucky that the government understood, and Melbourne's continued to thrive with local musics. You know, my big saying's always been, you have to be a leader, not a follower. I find in America, once there's an American sound or a type of music, everyone jumps on board. Whereas I've always thought you've got to try and be one step ahead. Whether you can be very wrong. Spit Ends were a great example of that. They were colour, they were weird, they flipped people out overseas. But they were certainly on the right track. They were almost as big as the Beatles in Canada, but Could we crack America properly? No, it's always been tough. Perhaps I was a bit naive and didn't realise after reading all these books now how much payola and graft went on. But
where was the major American influence coming from? What were the bands?
Look, there was a great diversity of bands. You had your Kiss, you had your really hard rock bands, and then all of a sudden the Californian sound, which I actually loved, believe it or not.
Eagles,
Poco, Linda Ronstadt, and that whole scene. And as far as music goes, it's been very cyclic in America. New York was big business in every level. Then LA sort of fought back. Nashville's always been there, and Nashville's become more and more important. Not for old Hicksville country hats, but you feel proud. When I went there in the late 70s and walked into Nashville, there's signs that make you feel that, you know, the music business was, it was rock and roll in the 70s. There was TVs out the window. There was wild parties. You know, it was part of it. But the music business grew up.
Mm.
You look at sport today, and the sportsmen have got limited careers. If I manage some of these blokes, I just grab them and give them a whack. Seriously, you've got your chance, take it. Whereas the music business has now become seriously big business.
Mm. And we did grow up, and you with it, because by the 80s, you're now promoting and calling the shots for Kylie Minogue, Cold Chisel, and Jimmy Barnes. You were bringing the Police and Sting out to Australia. That was must have been a fabulous decade.
Oh, look, it was, again, leading, not following. There was a new music movement coming out of England, and we jumped aboard that. England was a very strange place. It was so influential musically as I was growing up. It still continues to be. But no different to a lot of our big Australian acts. A lot of the big English acts could never crack America. And when I first went to England, and yes, we did have huge success with Kylie, and I still can't understand that Neighbours and Home and Away are two of the most successful shows in the world that have never been shown or properly promoted in America. I mean, do they have to remake it like The Office? It was just bizarre. And when I used to go to England, I used to feel like a convict taking coals to Newcastle. What Australian music could be better than ours? And look, there were some incredible bands there in England. There was no doubt, and the whole Beatles, Stones, the whole Carnaby Street, etc. But I always felt America was much warmer towards Australians in general.
And why? Why did they like Australians?
Look, it's a funny thing to say, but if one good thing came out of the Vietnam War, and I was fortunate enough to be in the last draw, and I didn't panic about it at all. And a lot of my mates had been caught up in previous years, had done things, and for those who came back, they were always affected, seriously. And I missed out, thank the Lord I did, but that was just the luck of the draw. It was the last year of it. But what I did find many years later, when you get in amongst it, not, you know, Hollywood, Beverly Hills, not Manhattan, you go out into real America and you say you're Australian, there was genuine love in the air because we were there with the Americans, for right or for wrong, there was genuine love for Australians in America.
And therefore for our music?
It certainly didn't hurt our music, and it certainly, I mean, Australia was a fantasy back then. There was a lot of ignorance. I'll never forget Michael Eisner, who was the head of Disney at the time, and they were very keen to sign Yothu Yindi, you know, and I was very proud because I worked with a lot of Indigenous music. They were the first act to have a number one song, Treaty, and he said to me, do they have TVs in the Outback? I'll never forget it. But there was a real fantasy about coming here. Americans thought, oh, how far? And when you think about it, going from Melbourne or Sydney to London is way further than coming on from LA to Australia. But there was a genuine intrigue and interest. I think Crocodile Dundee made a massive difference.
Mm.
And, you know, believe it or not, one of the first hits in America was Sister Janet Mead. the Lord's Prayer. A girl from Sydney that was on the label that backed me up and distributed me Festival Records. And then, of course, Olivia, the Bee Gees. But, you know, Maniacs tried and failed. And but I think there's been a real genuine bond between Australia and America.
Is there a favourite decade for you? Of the four decades you've been in the industry, is there, musically, is there a favourite for you?
Look, the 80s were unbelievable, both from a local point of view and for bringing international acts out here. You know, I lived and breathed Australian music, but working with some of the big international acts opened doors for me over there and helped a lot. Then I guess we took a pop phenomenon there, and Mushroom was a rock label. A lot of people thought I was going crazy. But Kylie, to see her so strong to this day, she is Australia's greatest export. She's our queen, that girl.
Mm.
Then you look at Jason, Dannii, Peter Andre, and a lot of people were going, this is the end of Mushroom. Well, let me tell you, you got to pay your bills. And as I got older, I realised that it's not just about what I like and being a fan of, it's about appealing to generations and different generations. I mean, kids are getting into music much younger now than when I was young. I didn't buy my first singles till I was 12 or 13. There's kids now that are 1.5, 2 years of age. I mean, kids go to concerts at 5 and 6.
Mm.
And music is a therapy. Music is love and fun, and so it should be. And there's so many different styles of music, but great music will always stand the test of time.
What do you think we do in music that's better than the Americans?
Look, I think Australia is a place, is somewhere that Americans always enjoy touring. We speak English. They get treated well out here. A lot of people don't realise how big the country is in the sense of what our population is. But I guess that we're a bit more honest in the sense that in America there's a famous song that I think Jimmy Barnes wrote, that Chisel did, called You've Got Nothing I Want. And that was about an American record company executive. Now, you've been there. Hollywood is a tough place. When you're hot, you're hot. When you're not, you're a waiter. It can be so depressing and so demeaning. One thing that happens in America, once you have a hit in America, you've got a life. You could be playing secondary, third, fourth, fifth markets, carnivals. America is a place where if you have a big hit, you can live on it forever. Australia is much more critical. And what we've tried to avoid with what I've been involved with all my life is one-hit wonders. We're trying to have people who've got careers. So, you know, there'll be artists that have got longer-term careers. It's a very different world technology-wise. So a great song goes up. It goes up worldwide. I think that that's given Australian artists a lot more chance as far as supporting this country, whether it be for film, television, music. I think it's a disgrace between radio support, government support. Paul Keating changed the nation. He made a commitment that has given so much success. We wonder why there's not big films and there's not, the studios aren't being used, etc. You know, it's a very competitive world out there. There's countries that all of a sudden weren't thought of as big touring countries, South America, the Eastern Bloc, etc. So, you know, I think that Australia's got to understand that it's got to fight for its right, whether it be for events, whether it be to support our own. I think it's sad that a lot of Australians in entertainment have got to go overseas to come back here and be successful.
And that all the Paul Keating innovations have all been pulled back.
They certainly have. I'll never forget Paul Keating saying to me one day, and he said, because he was a band manager of the 60s before my time, he managed a band from the West called the Ramrods, and he was very jealous in the sense he goes to me, Jesus, there was no money in it when I did it, mate. And look, he did so much for the creative side of things that I think it'd be nice, when you look at the trouble in the world, it's most probably not that relevant. But music brings happiness, films could bring happiness and reality, and I think that it's a big world, and it's unbelievable to see how the world is still trying to blow itself up.
It needs that happiness and fun more than ever.
Well, I've had a pretty lucky life and a lot of good fun. I think too many Australians don't realise what we have got here.
Mm, yeah.
And, very lucky that I'll never forget before the old man passed that he said to me, never go to the old country, and I never have. Mm. And I hear it's beautiful. That's not the point. I think there's so many people of my generation that came out here and put their foot on the ground and have brought their children up, and I'm lucky enough to have a couple of healthy, good kids, and one of them's going to take the mantle, hopefully, and you can't rule from the grave.
And look after his old man.
Well, I think it'll be a while. I said, that will not be beaten in my lifetime, but I hope you can beat me, son, after I'm gone.
Michael Gudinski, thank you for your time.